everybody, and welcome to another edition of Talking Sports. I'm Sergeant Rock, that's my Cox. Joe Stovall will be here sometime this afternoon. Here's what we're going to be talking about. Well, some of the things we're going to be talking about today. The NFL gets tough on domestic violence. The commish, he's issued a statement or a letter or a document that he sent out to all 32 NFL teams, and we'll tell you what's in that. Also, University of Southern Cal's Josh Shaw, he admits he was lying about his injuries. You know, he's the guy that said that he jumped off a second-story balcony or something like that to
save a cousin or
nephew who was supposedly drowning in a pool. A former Illini football star was charged with murder. He was a two-time Big Ten dude.
Yeah, exactly. Or Big Ten
All-American. And speaking of Illini, you know, their football season gets started tomorrow. They'll be playing Youngstown.
Volleyball as well.
And volleyball. Mike likes volleyball.
Oh, it's a great game.
Can't you tell?
I'm telling you, man. Huff is a great place to see a volleyball match.
I bet it is. Bring your binoculars.
You don't have to. That's the cool part.
I would bring mine. Let's see. And Peyton Manning gets fined $8,258.
I like what he said about it, though.
Now, how did you come up with that figure?
With Peyton Manning,
and 50 cents.
I wonder if they wanted pizza, too.
Yeah, that's
Papa John's.
Yeah, that's the first time Peyton Manning ever went off on somebody.
Did you see it? Because he really didn't go off.
But he just got in the dude's face. You know, people...
That's going off for Peyton.
Yeah, you know, because he's kind of passive. He just kind of...
On the stove, 50 more touchdown passes. Catch up to
him. Struts his way back to the huddle. Well, we got all that and more coming up on this edition of Talking Sports. You be sure and stay tuned.
Welcome back to Talk Sports WBCP 1580.
Somebody bring Joe a sandwich.
A big one, too. Wait a minute, before we get started, I just got called, you know, back in the 70s. What's the worst thing somebody could have called you if you, you know, walked past somebody?
Late for supper?
You know.
The worst thing?
Think about one of them old 70 lines that somebody could hit you with.
Some Huggy Bear.
Right.
Punk.
I just got called a jive turkey.
That's an old one. Ohio Players did a song.
Jive Turkey. You know it. And that's what I'm saying. When here it is, 21st century. And I got hit by a woman who said Jive Turkey.
Well, if you know what Jive Turkey meant back then, you know it's pretty much still relevant today.
And that's the point. So to get hit with a vintage line like, not, hey, what's going on, but what's up, you jive turkey?
Jive turkey.
You know what I did? I just kept walking. Because there's no response to jive turkey.
Well, it does beat what she could have called you.
No, no. You see, that's the thing, Mike. Jive turkey can, it like crosses elements of times. Yeah, right, and there's no boundary for jive turkey. Because you can take it for what it is.
You know.
Some colorful language to it.
I'm going to hate to admit this, but you remember back when, you know, everybody was getting into the CD craze? You know, just about everybody had a CD. If you didn't have an antenna on the back of your trunk, you wasn't cool.
You was a...
Huh?
What were you?
But my CD handle was Jive Turkey.
So if somebody said, breaker, 1-9.
Where you at, Jive Turkey?
Where you at, Jive Turkey?
Yeah, I am.
What's your 20, Jive Turkey?
What's your 20? Yep, that was my handle.
You know the lingo? But man, yes, I'm a little down. And then, as Mike said, the other thing, starving. I saw somebody brought you Steak and Shake.
They brought me a take home sack.
Oh my goodness! So you got the full meal deal: fries, a sandwich, and then you gonna slurp on the last bit of the
last
shake.
Last little bit of the shake.
Just rub it all in my face.
Oh man, it was excellent.
I bet you it was.
Samantha Carter brought. Thank you very much, Samantha. You know, Samantha with Jazzy looks.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they got a thing going over there. What is it, on the 8th? I forget the date right off
here. I think it's the 6th.
The 6th?
6th.
The
6th. 6th.
I think they're going to be raising money for Carol Hammonds. You know, she's running for Congress, Congresswoman.
You got to say the district,
103rd. Right. Anyway, for X amount of dollars, you get a facial, get your eyebrows done, and get manicure, pedicure.
You think we should go down there as a group?
You just walk in your head.
Don't think it'll help.
Hey, yeah. Hey, how many facials would we have to get?
I don't know. If I had to lay there a while.
If they break out the power sander, you should probably be.
That definitely would be for the feet.
Oh, a full body massage.
He's still looking for his $20. That's what he's
right. That's what he's. His head included.
Hey, before we get started, you know, last week we were talking about spiders.
Yeah.
You know, because you, I thought about you last night as I was climbing into bed.
I think we need to go straight to sports right now.
You should probably start talking.
Anyway.
You were climbing in the bed and thought about me.
Thought about you.
That just doesn't even. I'm a jive turkey.
I'm getting ready to tell you why. Because there was a spider trolling across my wall.
Okay, so you're climbing in the bed, you see a spider, and you think of me.
I said, Joe's scared of spiders.
Yeah.
And I said, what am I going to do?
Let me call Joe.
No, I didn't call Joe. I got up.
Facebook,
right. I got up and found the biggest shoe I could find. And now there's a shoe print and a smashed spider on my wall.
They just left it. That's a mob hit. Because what you're doing is sending a message to the other spider.
Exactly.
You see what happened to your friend?
For you.
Right.
I'm controlling across my wall. I mean, it was one of them, I guess they call it a garden spider.
Ooh. I'm going to tell you right now, I don't care what their name is. The only good spider is a dead spider.
Is a spider on Sergeant's wall.
That's right. Now, anyway, that's where I'm going to have to get that off there sooner or later.
But enough about jive turkey, take home a sack, facials, spiders.
Coming up a little later on the show, I got some tickets to give away to Illinois Youngstown State football. Well, Youngstown State football game tomorrow against U of I.
Fighting Penguins.
Is that what they're called? They're going to waddle into the stadium.
All the way from Antarctica.
Anyway, we're going to do that tomorrow. I mean, till a little later on in the show. Yeah. For tomorrow's game. I got two pairs.
Can you smell it in the air, though?
What, football? Oh, yeah.
Doesn't it feel good?
Mm-hmm. Well, they started last night.
And that's why I said, doesn't it feel good? You can cut the TV on, pick the newspaper up, radio, internet, whatever.
Send the old lady to the fridge for a couple of beers.
A lot of football widows were created last night.
Games, all the NFL teams played last night. Of course, they got to get down to their final cut of, what, 53?
53 by 3 o'clock.
Saturday. That's Saturday.
Yep.
But before we get into all that, the commission Thursday came out with a written policy that he sent out to all 32 owners who all agreed to it. In reference to the subject of domestic abuse, mm-hmm. where if you are a first-time offender, that's an automatic six-game suspension. Mm-hmm. Six-game suspension. And if you hit with another one, you're banned from the NFL for life, Joe. Mm-hmm. Now, is that getting tough or is that getting tough?
That is, first of all, you know, when we criticize people who are in positions of leadership for inaction and, you know, oversight, we have the right to do so. But the other thing we have to do is recognize when somebody has admitted a wrong and corrected it, and that's what he's done. I think the lunacy of the Ray Rice, Josh Gordon situation and the public outcry and what we have talked about on this show for weeks now, the fact that half of your audience is female, think common sense finally jumped in here. Now, you know, there are some people who are saying that this is not harsh enough.
And there are a lot of them saying it's a little bit too little too late.
Too little too late in the Ray Rice situation, but I think in terms of sending a message, because the thing that impressed me more about this, this goes for all league personnel.
Players or otherwise.
It doesn't matter if you are a manager, player, coach, general manager,
water
executive
boy.
Officer,
water boy.
Water boy, towel boy. If you're affiliated with the NFL and you're involved in domestic violence, the hammer comes down hard. 6 games. If you do it again,
you're done.
See you later.
Get your C. Shamika out there. Woo. Boy, don't you mess with me.
You know you already got one strike.
That's right.
You'll never play another football game again.
You know what's going to happen to you. Now, how does that fare into this situation?
That's what's going to be interesting, is to find out, you know, and I hope it never happens, but if it does, that second strike, what if it's just not necessarily factual?
Well, I think they'll have, just like what they've done with the drug offenses, et cetera, there'll be some sort of, obviously, investigation.
Mm-hmm. Because you know what they say, you don't have to be charged.
Right. But let's look at it.
We'll give you all the bullet points here. Right.
But, you know, let's be real with what we've seen over the past few years. Is young men, testosterone laden, amped up, whether they've come from a nightclub or, you know, whatever the scenario is. And then there's a confrontation with a young lady. I think, you know, what you guys are alluding to is the individual who baits, for lack of a better term, you get baited into
right. A
situation. We live in a different world. And because we live in a different world, here's the next thing that's going to have to happen. There's going to have to be some counseling and training instituted by the NFL with some of their athletes in the same fashion they do with substance abuse, the same fashion that they do with
finances.
You know, when they do the rookie symposium and some of the things they talk about, this is just a part of the change in our society. And when a law or rule or something like this is put into effect, there's also got to be some educational piece to it.
Well, they said that all the players are going to go through, you know, going to go through and have that training, even more so when they come in, you know, the rookies come in mm-hmm. at the beginning of the season. So let me get the bullet points here.
Why don't you give the bullet points? Do you have the bullet points?
I got the bullet points right here. I had them on down here somewhere, but that's just too much paper for me. So
you made your own bullet points.
I made my own bullet points.
His own piece of paper.
All right, let me see.
Kill a tree.
The policies apply to all incidents involving physical force, not just domestic abuse. So pretty much if you just grab them.
Don't touch Shamika.
That's right.
That's what that means.
So a 6-game suspension for all first offenses. It could be longer under certain circumstances.
I think that Ray Rice situation definitely
falls under certain circumstances. Yep.
If your woman, when the elevator door is open and you're standing and she's not,
you dragging her out by her hair.
Fred Flintstone.
Caveman 101.
Yeah, that's certain circumstances. Lifetime ban for second offense can apply for reinstatement after 1 year, but that don't mean
you get to come back.
You get to come back. Right. I'm thinking they just threw that in there. You know.
Well, it depends on the name of the person reapplying.
You think?
I think you think about it, it also goes to, as you guys just mentioned earlier, about what are the circumstances behind it, et cetera.
Okay. You know. Like you stated, Joe, policy applies to all NFL personnel, not just players. Everyone gets to start with a clean slate. So Ray Rice, serve your suspension, and you get to start all over again.
Yeah. He won't be grandfathered in for this.
So to speak. All right, those individuals identified as at risk for committing offenses are going to be offered counseling. Refusal could affect further discipline. So how do you figure they're going to go about that?
Well, you think about it. There's a lot of guys who've had a lot of allegations in the past who are still in the league right now. And I guarantee you, when this went out, there is a list from each, excuse me, of the 32 teams in the league.
The at-risk people.
Right.
And then other than that, they're just going to walk down the line and say, oh, man seems to have some anger issue management. Mm-hmm. Maybe he's at risk. Maybe he needs to get into this class.
Mm-hmm. And so privacy, you know, comes into play there. So, you know, it's not like you're going to be able to open the paper up.
They're going to put you on blast.
You know. Sergeant Rock of the Seattle Seahawks is an at-risk player.
Mm-hmm.
But I guarantee you, if you have any prior incidents on your shield, that has been reported to the league office in New York.
You fall into that category.
Yes.
You're okay. Taking the class.
And like you said, confidential counseling is offered to all personnel and families. So, those are the bullet points. It's going to be interesting to see how this plays out. We got to see what the first incident happens.
Or hopefully,
if there be one.
Right. Hopefully, this will deter any incidents. I think now, when you know there's teeth in the law, when you know the consequences, I still think instead of 6 games, it should have been 8. Should have been a half a season.
Didn't they bump Rice up to 6 or to 4?
Who?
I thought they did.
Yeah. He's still at 2. But I think it should be an 8-game, half season, because I think you got to send a clear message. And the reason why I'm talking about, think about Michael Vick. And the way we responded as a society with the Michael Vick situation.
He did dogs.
Right. So we need to do something about that. We're going to phone lines 359-9227, 359-9227. Talking sports, go ahead, caller.
Yeah, it's a good thing that they came out with the rule, but the thing is, he should have came out with it when Belcher killed his girlfriend in Kansas City. I don't know what took so long for him to come out with this ruling then. And to me, Ray Rice should have been suspended for the whole season for knocking a woman out.
Mm-hmm.
And they didn't release the video of what was in the elevator. If we would have saw what took place in that elevator, we'd be looking at this a whole lot different. He should have been suspended the whole season, along with pay and counseling.
Excellent point.
It's good that he got the rule. When he made it over into the personal staff with the NFL, the players, the coaches, and the owners. Now, see, that's where the cover comes in. What you going to do with your money say? That's where I believe that came into play, because everyone's waiting on now. What are you going to do with your money say?
And I think he's taking too long to make a decision on that when, you know, if it would have been a player, that decision would have been made months ago.
That's right, exactly.
Well, that's
all I got to say.
Well, we appreciate you calling. You hit us on Talking Sports anytime.
All right.
Take care.
The other thing, if he just makes it player only, then you're going to get sued.
Yeah.
You know, it's discriminatory, I would think, at some level. And, you know, although Irsay, I may be wrong, but I don't remember him being accused of any type of domestic abuse or violence or anything when he got arrested. It was just drunk and
but I think
a lot of cash. But I understand the point. Yeah, he needs to make a decision on that.
And I think that the issue with Irsay is also the, going to your point, amount of cash.
Did he have a bunch of pills?
Yeah, right. He had a lot of prescription drugs that weren't prescribed to him. And this is not the first time Jim Irsay has had some issues. He's been in rehab several times. And so if he was a player, Jim Irsay would have been hit immediately with an entire season.
Right.
I think the only issue you probably have now with an owner is that how do you punish an owner?
Pocketbook.
Right. So now you've got to set a standard in terms of what is the appropriate punishment for somebody who, for lack of a better term, receives compensation from the exploits of the players on the field.
Well, maybe they're waiting to see what happens, plays out in court.
And see, that's where, you know, a lot of times they make decisions before guys even go through their trial.
Yeah.
You know, the NFL is you know, notorious for saying, hey, Sergeant Rock, bam, 4 games.
But wait, man. I haven't been convicted, man.
Right. And then you can come back and appeal it. And guess who hears your appeal? The commissioner.
They got it suspended. Yeah.
Right.
Right.
So he just changed his hats. He's like one of them.
Turns it to the side.
Right. He's one of them old fishing weekend judges. I don't have time to listen to this.
Penalties stands.
That's it.
We were talking right before the caller called about cutting down on hopefully it would cut down to where it never happens again. The interesting part about that is that in one of your bullet points, Sarge, you talked about 6 games or 8 games or whatever it was for the first offense. And then
6 games
for the first offense. Second offense, you're terminated. But then a little bit further on, it says depending upon the circumstances. So in reality, that 6 games also means up to and including being banned.
Yeah.
So if the circumstances are warranted, you're gone. What player's going to want to take that chance?
Well,
I mean, I know there's some out there.
Well, I think those circumstances depends on the amount of abuse.
Well, I think it depends on
the severity of it. In other words,
how good a night's sleep Roger Goodell got the night before. Because what my interpretation of a lot or excessive or whatever may be different from yours, but it depends on his mood on a given day. So, who's going to take that chance?
I'm thinking it's going like this. You know, a couple of slaps, you know, dang, you get your 6 games.
Where do you draw
but,
the line?
But, you know, you a couple of slaps, you step on an arm, you know, you blacken a couple of eyes. Then you get into your certain circumstances.
Well, but, I mean, what's the difference between a slap and a punch?
That's whether you do
how
it
you
with,
draw that line? You
with an open hand or a closed fist.
You can't draw that line, though. Not based on that. And for those of you that are only listening on radio, you should see Joe with his head in his hands right now.
We talk about beating up women.
I mean, he's given a sliding scale for abuse. I'm sorry. Oh, a couple of slaps.
Yeah, you know, that's when you get into a certain circumstance.
No, I don't think that's where... I truly believe when they talk about certain circumstances, as the caller so eloquently stated, if we just saw what happened within that elevator...
It would have been more than 2 games.
Right.
And you know, I concur.
Right. But when you say... A cup, no. You touch. That's what I said earlier. You touch. So imagine you see a player at a nightclub, restaurant, public forum, or private party, whatever, and he gets into a verbal altercation with a female and puts his hands on her.
6 games.
That's cool. It. Right. This ain't a couple of slaps. You touch her, you're done.
6 games.
And I think that goes to Mike's point. That message is now transmitted throughout the league. What guy is going to take that chance? Now, to answer that, the same guys who take the chance with the drug policy, the same guys who take the chance with PEDs, the same guys who do it with alcohol.
Somebody else's prescriptions in the car.
Same guys who do it with gambling. All the, you have to, as I said earlier about how our society has changed, think about it. Things that were not punishable generations ago, now it's not even close to the level of commitment that would happen back then, i.e., as I just said, don't touch Shamika. Don't touch her. Period.
In an interesting probably byproduct of this, it'll cut down on the groupies.
It'll do two things. It'll cut down on the groupies and social activity. Are you now going to put yourself in a situation as a young, successful athlete.
Then we're not talking about Pac-Man.
Right.
Of course you are.
So you think guys will still go to the nightclubs, they'll still get in the VIP, they'll still have multiple bottles of alcohol.
And everybody in the world knows about this ruling.
Right.
He touched me. He pushed me.
Right. You actually think guys are going to...
I sure do.
I disagree. I think what's going to happen, two things you're going to see. A lot of stuff going underground, meaning as opposed to me going to the nightclub and being there, now I'm at home. I may do the same activities, but now it's at home. I'm not going to be in public. Number two, going to Mike's point, the number of women that individuals come in contact with, they're going to be a lot smarter about that.
And the guest list will get vetted.
Right. And number three, the same level of scrutiny that we're seeing now, we talk about law enforcement and dash cams and GoPros, body cams, you're going to see a lot of athletes.
Yep.
Wearing GoPros or making sure
somebody's filming everything
that's happening, because it goes to the other point that Mike brought up earlier about the false accusation. So this is a slippery slope that we're going down, and we're sliding on a goose grease suit.
Well, then the bodyguard business just got real happy.
Oh. Excellent point. And those bodyguards will be what? Filming.
Mm-hmm, absolutely.
It'll go from being an actual bodyguard to really being more of a video consultant.
I mean, you're 6'5", 297 pounds. Do you really need a bodyguard?
Yeah, you do.
Yes, you.
Come on, Sarge. Think about that for what you just said for a moment.
It's not that I'm 6'5", 270 pounds.
It's that now there's a rule of the law or the rule of the land of where I work. And there's a whole bunch of people out there that see it as they're V. Stiviano. Hello.
Right. Who?
V. Donald Sterling's V. Stiviano.
Right.
No, he didn't touch her.
But she was an opportunist is the point.
We're all right, right.
And so if there's a female who may not, you know, I know you can't believe it because it doesn't fall in your eyes. But, you know, if there's a woman who doesn't like you, I mean, every woman likes you.
Of course.
But if there's a woman who doesn't like you and really wants to hit you hard, this is what can happen. That's what going to Mike's point about having bodyguards and security cameras and all this other stuff. This is just a change in the landscape. Is the rule correct? But as the caller indicated, and I agree with him 1,000%, it shouldn't have gotten to this point. I mean, you have to applaud them for doing it, but it never shouldn't have got to this point. This is something that should have been done ages ago.
Well, you know, they said a lot of this falls under the
collective bargaining.
Yeah, and the conduct agreement.
Mm-hmm.
But there's been no teeth in that
right.
Moral clause or ethics clause or whatever it's called in everybody's the contract that's signed with the NFL, because the commissioners, whoever they have been, have done nothing. In terms of putting some bark behind, right. Or putting some bite behind the bark.
I think
the caller made a point about Belcher. That's kind of a moot point because he killed himself.
Right.
So who are you going to punish for there? Sure.
But I guess my last comment on this is there's a financial ramification in terms of making this decision.
Yep.
And Roger Goodell recognized, as I've been talking about this for a while, your female audience is growing exponentially. Your marketing to females is growing exponentially. The NFL shop that sells all the gear, et cetera, now has its own women's division in terms of jerseys and other accessories. We're talking about billions of dollars. You can't treat half of your audience the way they've been treated. And if they'd have continued on this line, imagine, you know, like in October when it's Breast Cancer Month. Now, you got all the teams that come out and wear the pink and things of that nature, but it's a contradictory message. You're out here supporting breast cancer.
But saying it's okay to punch
them. Punch them, right. And I think that's why they had to sit down in the executive office and say, this isn't good business.
Well, and you know, too, that social media is still hammering Roger Goodell over it.
Right. Oh, even though he made this move, he still, because there's some people like, why is it even a two-strike policy?
Yeah, you know, when I read the article and was getting these bullet points and whatnot, when you go down, look down in the comments, there were a lot of people still bashing for this.
Yeah.
You know, like it's too little, too late, and why now, and this, you know, those sort of comments.
Right. And like I said, being a leader of any organization, when you make a decision like this, everybody's not going to praise you on it.
Yeah, you're going
to
take your shot.
You're going to, and so that's to be expected. And the people have the right to give them the shots. Because going back to the Ray Rice incident, when we talked about it, he could have made that could have been his Adam Silver moment. Imagine Adam Silver not doing anything with Donald Sterling and then coming out today saying, in the future, if an owner has this type of conduct, then this is what would happen. People be ripping him.
Let me ask you, do you think the NBA going to follow suit with a policy of their own?
I think all pro sports should.
Mm-hmm. You have to. There's got to be some consistency. It goes to the point of two things. Number one, the folks who are least protected in our society, we got to protect them the most. Whether it be the elderly, children, or females, you got to protect them. The second thing is, as we just talked about, financially. If you're looking at your customer base and 50% of it is female, then guess what you got to do? You got to take care of that customer base.
And none of the other major sports, professional sports, are exempt from any of this. I mean, it happens everywhere in society. So
right.
Do you want to be the league that doesn't institute the policy and then something happens?
Right.
So look for something soon from the NBA and Major League Baseball and NHL and everybody else.
Yep.
NASCAR, soccer, whoever, any professional sport.
You got it.
Speaking of protection, USC's Josh Shaw has admitted to lying about that he jumped off a second-story balcony to save his drowning nephew sprung both his ankles.
Well, didn't he jump off a balcony, but just not for that reason?
Right. We just haven't heard the reason as to why he jumped off the balcony.
Yeah, but I look for that to be coming up here next week sometime.
My first question is, why the extravagant lie?
Because he was doing something he wasn't supposed to be doing.
Yeah, exactly.
We all know that.
That, right.
Yeah, yeah.
But now comes, what was the old saying? It's not the crime. It's the cover-up.
Yep, exactly.
What did you do as a young collegiate athlete that was so egregious that you had to convince your coach and everybody around you that you were saving a drowning 7-year-old?
Well, you know, I'm thinking you could have came. Was there a pool in the area?
Well,
at the time he was jumping, what would the little boy be doing out in the pool at that time of night?
And then they come.
Well, but Sarkisian has said, you know, he's never had any reason to doubt the kid.
Right. Said he's always been a good.
He's always been, you know, upfront and a good kid. There's nothing in his background that would indicate it other. So nothing at all. So
yeah, he was sneaking out of somewhere.
Yeah, probably a family member. So
that. I'm leaning to where you're at in the fact that either A, he was involved with someone.
He couldn't go out the way he came in.
Yeah,
Pacers.
Keep talking, sir.
He couldn't go out the same way he came in.
Right. So, and he had to make a choice. Exactly. And the choice was
to jump off the second story balcony.
Beating I'm about to get?
Or jump off this balcony.
I think I'll jump.
Now, when the police was canvassing the area, because I guess there was supposed to have been some type of open window somewhere, and supposed to be a burglary or something.
Yeah, there was a burglary. Right? He was stealing something.
And the description, when it came back, it came back, you know, tall brother with dreads. You know, there was a lot of them around there. And in Southern California. So they said the prescription came back to look like Josh Shaw. And doing when they was going throughout the apartment complex, talking to people, they happened to talk to his girlfriend. So when they was given the description of the said individual, or as they like to call him, the perp, she was like, hey, that sounds like my boyfriend, Josh Shaw. And so, the senior quarterback, he admitted to lying about how he suffered an ankle injury last weekend and has been suspended indefinitely from the school. From the team, rather. Shaw said he suffered a pair of high ankle sprains Saturday night after jumping from the second story of an apartment complex to save a 7-year-old nephew who was struggling in the pool. Shaw said his nephew did not know how to swim. He admitted to team officials on Wednesday that the story was completely fabricated. Coach says, we are extremely disappointed in Josh. He let us down. And all I have to say is nothing is in the background, like you said, led us to doubt him when he told us of his injuries. Then he goes on to say, I appreciate that Josh has now admitted that he lied and has apologized. Although the type of behavior is out of character for Josh, it is unacceptable. Honesty and integrity must be the center of our program. Yeah. But like I said, you know, when they was talking to the canvassing, they talked to the young lady and said, that sounds like my boyfriend.
So I wonder if the NCAA is going to put an NFL policy into effect right now today.
Probably not.
What, no jumping off of balconies?
No.
No lying?
Don't go back home.
Right.
No sneaking.
He obviously never stopped by Fort Bragg on his way to USC.
No, awesome.
Man with your feet together and roll.
That's right.
Yeah, but what was the surface that he was jumping onto?
Well, and then
probably concrete too. So. Probably concrete.
But Michael, you know, was his nephew even there?
No.
No.
That's what I'm asking. That's how this thing is unraveling. Is that
there's no ambulance call?
The nephew is in a completely different area,
New York,
of where.
but it's
Antarctica.
But he did have the presence of mind to call his sister, who said, "Yes, he's a hero. He saved my son from drowning in the pool."
She's a part of it.
Yeah,
and that's what I said. It's the, not the crime; it's the cover-up. Because now you got multiple people involved in it, and
you know that old saying: the problem with lying is you never remember what you said.
Yeah.
So what are you thinking? I'm thinking, you know, his girlfriend stays a couple of doors down. He's down in there in Chabela's house. You know what I'm saying?
He could have been, there's so many different things. The point is, to jeopardize your senior starting cornerback for a nationally recognized program.
Was he a captain too or something mm-hmm. like
that? And his
your draft stock.
There you go.
Because it goes back, we talked about character, integrity, and all these
things. Man, Ty.
He's still playing.
Yeah, but
he ain't talking about a girlfriend anymore.
Right. He ain't talking about anything. Man, Ty walking around like Helen Keller. He says nothing. And I think this is the, you know, this goes to the center piece of you think you know an individual. But the old saying, crisis reveals character, it doesn't create it. We see in a critical situation, Josh Shaw decided the truth ain't worth it. I'd rather lie than tell you what really happened.
Because I got to go back to that locker room.
Right.
And he's there waiting.
So,
my opinion.
I would like to really, you know, it'll play out in about a month or so.
Oh, by the time the Pac-10 season starts, or whatever they call it now.
Now, my follow-up to this would be, if you are, both of you, head coaches, how long do you keep Josh Shaw out? One game, four games, entire season? What do you do?
Well, he can't play.
Well, he can't play because of the ankle injury. Yeah,
right.
But I'm saying in terms of even when he's healthy.
He can't do anything with the team.
Right now, he's just
He's definitely suspended.
Yeah.
Yeah, but Mike said,
I'll bring him back sooner or later.
You'll bring him back when the league starts.
Nah, when his ankles get better.
I bet it'll be right about the time the conference starts.
Right.
But, you know, I'm surprised, you know, I guess, you know, they really don't have to. College don't have the same thing like, you know, like the pros have. You know, you can't ride a motorcycle.
Don't they have it, though?
Mm-hmm. Oh, do they?
Yeah, they have the moral.
Yeah, there's a moral clause.
Oh, really?
Yeah, when
you can't do certain things.
Yes.
Yep.
No different than, you know, you can't work.
For fear of injury.
You know, participate in other sports or extreme activities.
They got to protect their investment, man.
Right. You think about going to USC is probably, what, 50 grand?
Per year. Well, Northwestern's 40-something per year.
Right, and that's a private school. And USC, it's public.
The entire state school system. Yeah,
but you figure in L.A., that's about 50 grand. Go to USC, so that's $200,000 investment they're making over a 4-year period. A lot of stuff you cannot do, which makes sense.
And what's really surprising is locally, you see a lot of the U of I football players riding them scooters around.
Yeah,
that surprises me that they're allowed to do that, but particularly without a helmet on, you'd think they'd wear one.
Yeah, well, you know, he'd look really funny riding down the street on a scooter with his U of I football helmet.
That's true. But when that car hits them because they're not paying attention, it's not his face that's getting
face mask, mask, no face
yeah,
mask.
Yeah, face mask. There you got it.
The kazoo bubble helmet. You know, that's what everybody
wants. Pads on and everything. So, yeah, I can't wait to come out and find out what dude that he did, because I bet you this is going to be funny as all get out.
Yeah, it is.
You know,
come on. Definitely is.
Did you really have to lie about that?
And you know when the story really comes out, you know what he's going to get it, catch it the most? In the locker room.
Oh, yeah.
You know your peers.
They were like, dude.
Really?
Really?
And he's going to be getting asked about it for the next year.
You know what's going to happen? There's going to be, you know, the bench in front of the locker.
Oh, they're going to have reference.
Somebody going to be standing on the bench when they come in. All of them going to be standing on the bench. They're going to jump at the same time.
Oh,
I'm not worthy.
Wait until he goes to Oregon or UCLA for that.
Right.
Stanford. Oh, wait till he goes to Stanford.
They'll be very creative with their cheering section.
I bet you're going to hear a lot of jump.
Right.
Jump around.
Jump around, or you're going to hear, don't jump. Josh, don't jump. Don't do it. Mm-hmm. They'll catch a lot of grief for that.
I have one other story before we go to break. No, we better go to break now. But before we do, we got some Illinois football tickets to give away. Bam!
Man, you actually showed them.
Section 129, row 6, seats 5 and 4. That's right down front.
That is.
That's right down. We got some tickets right down front. We're going
to
take.
Close to the field.
Hey, Jazz. We're getting ready to give away some tickets. Take caller number 3. We'll take caller number 3 yet.
Caller number 3 at 359-9227, 359-9227. Youngstown State versus the 2014 version of Fighting Illini men's football.
When we come back, we're going
to
talk
about, as opposed to the women's football team.
Yeah.
They've been pretty good.
They're undefeated.
Yeah.
So call number 3 at 359-9227. You can win these pair of tickets to see the University of Illinois play tomorrow.
Starts
meanwhile,
at 11 o'clock tomorrow morning, by the way.
Tailgate gets underway about 6.
Yes.
You start tailgating right now.
Anyway.
Some have.
All right. We'll be back with more Talking Sports after these. Call and get these tickets.
Welcome back, Talking Sports WBCP 1580. Sergeant Rock.
Sup?
When we was going to break, you had a couple of tickets for tomorrow morning, 11 o'clock kickoff at Memorial Stadium for the Fighting Illini 2014 football season against Youngstown State, the Fighting Penguins.
Yeah, Martell Miller won those tickets.
Well, congratulations to Martell, being the third caller.
Now, you got to get down here before 5 o'clock.
Because you get here at 5:01.
The door going to be locked.
And your tickets will not be available. And
Sarge will be gone.
Yeah. And probably your Sarge will be sitting in your seats tomorrow morning if you cut the game on Big Ten Network.
I'll be the one.
Waving from section 129.
How you doing?
Was it row? Was it row 6?
Row 6. Right down front.
That is.
Of course, rows 1 through 5 are like taped over or something.
I was going to say, you don't want to be too close because if you're too close,
you can't see the game.
Right, because the players are standing up and they're blocking your view.
Hey, you know, they kind of frown on you like they did to me last year when I'm hollering like down in front.
And they're turning looking at you.
Yeah.
Like,
come on, man, I can't see the game.
Don't make me come down there and grab your face mask, number 73, punk.
Buy better seats next time.
You jive turkey. Move on out the way.
Buy better seats.
I've never bought a ticket in my life.
That's why you can't see the game.
Are you serious?
Yeah, that's why you can't see the game.
You know the best seats, though, at the Memorial Stadium? If you're in, like, row 25. Because the overhang from the top section is right over you. So you're shaded from any elements, sun, rain, wind.
No.
But you're close enough. You can survey the entire field. The
best seats. Oh, okay. The bestest seats.
At home.
No. Up under the press box and the thing. Mm. The wheelchair section.
Nope. Best seats are in the press box.
Yeah. No, the colonnades.
Even the old press box that I used to go to. Best seats are up there.
The colonnades where they got the
climate control,
food,
lots of food,
chilled shrimp, shaved meats,
plenty of TVs to see the replay. They won't show.
So how do you get bars.
So how do you get in though?
Oh, you just cut a nice fat check to get in the colonnade section. Well,
I'm not gonna do that. So I'll take the seats under the press box.
I forgot. You've never paid
in the wheelchair section.
So now that we are giving away tickets.
There's no standing lines at the counters if you want to get a hot dog or a cold drink.
Where he's going with this, I don't know and I don't want to touch it. I'm scared.
That's right.
But tomorrow is the kickoff of.
They give you free candy.
Keep talking, Joe.
I can't.
Louder.
I can't talk over this. But tomorrow, the Big Ten season kicks off for Illinois. Now, last night, as you said at the beginning of the show, the 2014 season kicked off for
Minnesota,
Eastern Illinois, and a plethora of teams.
Mm-hmm.
First statement I have to make, goodbye, Johnny Manziel.
Johnny Football who?
Hello, Kenny Hill.
Who?
Kenny Hill is the quarterback who replaced Johnny Manziel at Texas A&M. And him and the Aggies went to South Carolina.
And beat the old ball coach
Beat him.
Beat him hard.
And the thing that I was most impressed with. Now, somebody made a statement and said, when the players around you change, but the results are still the same, that means the coach has a lot to do with it. Kevin Sumlin has got to be the hottest coach right now. Because Johnny Manziel for the past 2 years was the talk of collegiate football. And everybody was under the assumption that a lot of the stuff that was done for his success was Johnny Manziel. You get Kenny Hill who walks out against the Gamecocks and goes 44 for 60.
For 500 some odd yards?
511 yards. Three touchdowns. And the key is no interceptions. He threw the ball 60 times against the number 9th ranked team in the nation.
Isn't that Steve Spurrier's team?
Yeah, ball coach.
That's what he normally does, is come to your place
and throw 60
times and roll up ridiculous amounts of yards.
Well, what's really amazing about that stat is only three touchdowns. So there was a lot of up and down that field. He just lit them up for
it. Right. You're exactly right. First drive right out the box. 80 yards right down the field. Touchdown. So.
That'd make a defensive coach look at his nose on
him. Dude, make him do more than that.
Right. Make him clean out his locker.
Backing up the desk.
I was thoroughly impressed with that. The other thing, James Franklin. You know, he's coach at Penn State now. But he was coaching at Vanderbilt. And now Derek Mason is taking over.
It was class.
Vanderbilt got torched by Temple at home. They had to wait. It was almost a two-hour delay because of lightning and severe weather. And after all of that, the people who in the great state of Tennessee, I don't think wanted to wait that long for that type of beatdown. Vanderbilt looked like the Vanderbilt before pre-James Franklin. Mm. So it's a lot of the landscape, collegiate football, Mississippi beat Boise last night. Mississippi's SEC team looked pretty strong. And then you mentioned Minnesota and Eastern Illinois. Eastern Illinois, Dino Babers, his coach.
New coach.
He moved on to Bowling Green. So they've got a new coach there, new system.
Jimmy Garofalo went to the NFL.
Yep. They brought in a transfer from the University of Kentucky, Whitlow. He didn't do too well last night.
Nah, he didn't.
Had to pull him. They lost 42-20 against the Golden Gophers. I don't know if the Golden Gophers can celebrate too much on that. They were supposed to win that game.
Yeah, they really were.
But now, Fighting Illini. Wes Lunt era starts tomorrow. Now we've kind of gut punched Illinois on the show for the past few years.
Sarge has consistently.
Yeah, I snuck a few shots in.
Well, yeah, but he's consistent.
Oh yeah, he. Come and what is your favorite saying? Illinois what?
Sucks.
But now you start against Youngstown State tomorrow. There's a lot of questions, but almost more on a positive side. You know, you lose Nathan Shieldhouse, who's the total yardage leader in the history of the university. But you bring in Wes Lunt, highly recruited quarterback coming out of Rochester 3 years ago. He went to Oklahoma State, started for, what, six games before he got hurt?
Yeah.
And then could not come back on the field and lost his job. He decided to transfer to University of Illinois, sat out last year. Now, he was named the starter last week, which, I mean, he was named the starter, as we said last week.
Signed a transfer.
Right. August of 2013.
So, what, you didn't think he could get his job back at Oklahoma State?
Didn't they change coaches or something?
No. Same coach. Mike Gundy.
Still Mike Leach?
Mike Gundy. Is still the coach over. But I think what happens with programs like that, you know, they bring some gunslingers in because they like to put points on the board. And you'll see Oklahoma State tomorrow night against the defending champs, Florida State. But back to Illinois and Wes Lunt. You know, there's the drum beat that you hear coming from Memorial Stadium is a signal saying, you know, get ready for a winning era of football. My thing is, you had the offense last year that scored about 31 points a game.
And you won. That gave up 50 points a game.
And there's the question.
Mm-hmm. They say, you know, they've gotten better. I guess we'll find out tomorrow.
Well, they've gotten better based on time and the fact that a lot of freshmen play.
Last year, yeah.
A lot of sophomores play. Yeah.
You've brought in some junior college players. And I think the other thing is the schedule. With the realignment of the Legends and Leaders division, and now you just have a natural
East-West,
you know, certain teams you just won't see Illinois playing anymore. I won't say playing anymore, but not on a regular basis.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You think about the fact that Michigan State, Michigan, Ohio State.
Penn State.
Maryland, Rutgers, are all in the East.
Indiana's in the East, right? Purdue's in the West.
So you think about teams like Michigan, Ohio State, Michigan State that just won't fall on the schedule on a regular basis when in the past, you know.
They got to be a positive.
That's the right. That's what I'm saying. That's because of scheduling. So now you get maturity on the defensive side through time, a positive, as you said, about scheduling changes, the excitement about West Lund. I say to you before the season even starts, the conversation right now is Illinois wins 6 games this year. Do you believe they can?
That's possible. I mean, I don't know what the schedule is right now.
Say that again.
Say it's possible.
You should go 3-1 before the or 3-0 before the conference.
You got to go on the road to Washington.
Yeah. Well, okay, you might be 2-1.
Not knowing what Washington has. You know, Youngstown State, you know, this is where Jim Tressel cut his teeth.
He's back over there, isn't he? He's president or something like that at the university, I thought I heard.
Some special consultant or something. Right.
Yeah, he's back over there. And the coach that used to be here, Eric Wolford, is the head coach of Youngstown State.
Yep.
So he was here with Zook, I guess. To beat Youngstown State, because Bishop Sankey's no longer in Washington, you should be able to beat them.
Mm-hmm.
And then who's the other one? Texas State or something like that in the preconference.
Mm-hmm.
So ideally, you should be 2-1 going into the conference.
Mm-hmm.
You're playing in the East, so who don't you have to play this year? Don't have to play Ohio State. Don't have to play Michigan State, right?
Mm-hmm.
You don't play the states. So you got to worry about Nebraska. Wisconsin,
mm-hmm.
Iowa, who a lot of people are picking to win the division.
Mm-hmm.
So there's, we'll say, for sake of discussion, there's 3 losses there.
Mm-hmm.
You just win your other games that you should win. You should beat Purdue. You should beat Northwestern. And whoever the third one is, I can't think of it off the top of my head. So if you go 2-1 in the preseason, win the games you should in conference.
That's 6 victories.
And steal one, there's 6 victories.
Mm-hmm.
The question is going to come down to, like it did last year, if the defense could have got a stop, if they could have tackled somebody once or twice and a half, Illinois got 6 wins last year.
I will say this. The concept of, you know, last week we talked about where they said they want to get Aaron Bailey on the field because of the 100 rushes that Nathan Shieldhouse executed last year. They want to get him in there to do some of that. But my concern is, did Nathan Shieldhouse run the ball 100 times out of running formation or design, as you indicate? Or was he running because the offensive line, A, couldn't protect him, or B, his receivers couldn't get open, and he had to make that business decision of, do I take the chance of throwing it or do I run with it? And so I say that to say this, now that Wes Lunt's on the field, I think we all can safely say he's the prototypical big pocket passer. So he's not going to just generate that type of rushing offense that Nathan Shieldhouse did. And if it's, you know, case, if it's A or B, where I said offensive line doesn't protect, or you don't, your receivers can't get separation and get open, then what happens to West Lund? Other key, West Lund hasn't had contact
in a year and a half, 2 years.
2 years. So
everything I hear about Wes Lunt is he's the perfect kid to be playing quarterback in this situation. He's smart, he's not too high, not too low, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But as you said, he hasn't been banged on, and he was hurt out of OK State.
Mm-hmm.
While we were talking about this, I was thinking of 3 players I want to see play. The JC kid from, I think it's New York, Jihad Ward, because they say he's a man among boys. and then the two freshman receivers, Dudek and kid from Springfield, Sacred Heart, Turner, mm-hmm. Nick Turner. I've heard good things about those two young men, different people.
Yeah.
And if they are what everybody says they are, then Lund's got people to throw to.
Yeah. Now, remember last year at this time, Illinois took on SIU, and SIU basically took them to the wire, mm-hmm. failed two-point conversion, and then I think a touchdown at the end that fell short for SIU. I guess my gauge for success moving forward, it's got to be a dominant performance on not the offense side of the ball, but the defense side of the ball. Because when you're going against, FCS?
FCS, yeah.
As opposed to, what is it, 1AA that we used to call it for years?
Right, 1AA, yeah.
What you're trying to show and indicate is your athletes on the defense side of the ball are much better than the athletes of the team on the offensive side of the ball. So I think that'll be the indicator in terms of what do you believe Illinois football is going to be in 2014.
Well, and you know, Youngstown State's a good club because they're getting love. Their division's polled, they're ranked, mm-hmm. I think, top 10, I believe. But you're right. I mean, Illinois, the defense has got to come out and throw a shutout 10 points or less, minimum.
Right.
And just be bringing the wood.
Yeah, this has got to be one of those games that by the third quarter,
it's over with.
Guys are rotating in and out. You know, Aaron Bailey's getting some love in terms of quarterbacking. You see multiple guys on the defensive side being rotated in. And this, you hate to reduce it down to this terminology, but turn this into almost a glorified scrimmage.
Yeah.
Where guys are just getting shots to play based on that.
Defensive linemen wearing number 5 and stuff.
There you go. So.
That would be me.
But he wouldn't pay for the jersey.
Right. Because he'd be sitting up in the wheelchair section.
Eating hot dogs.
And free candy. And telling people down in front.
Down in front.
So tomorrow, 11 o'clock.
And I got another pair of tickets to give away. We'll get those away before we go to the next break. So.
The color is 6.
Color what?
6. Just right. Be brave and try that.
Can you do that?
Yeah, before we go to break.
Okay.
Not now, people.
Speaking of Illini, Curtis D. Lovelace, an all-Big Ten center from Illinois who later became an Adams County Assistant State Attorney, was formally charged Thursday with first-degree murder of his wife.
Back in 2006, on Valentine's Day.
Yeah. Lovelace, a private practice lawyer in Quincy, is accused of suffocating Corey D. Lovelace, 38, on February 14, 2006. A month later, a coroner's jury ruled the cause of death undetermined. An autopsy reached the same conclusion. But details of Corey Lovelace's death were revealed during Thursday's hearing. Quincy Police Chief Rob Copley said that an investigation into her death was reopened in December 2013 after the department received new information. Somebody dropped it down.
Got that red lobster.
Lovelace was arrested without incident Wednesday near his Quincy law office. While playing for Illinois between 1986 and 1990, Lovelace was chosen team captain and was a starting center on the all Big Ten team during his junior and senior season. Yeah. He's going to be on that program called Snapped. You ever seen it? Saw that?
You know the bad part about all this, besides the death? He's a captain in the Illinois National Guard Judge Advocate General Corps.
Dad, he's a lawyer.
As I continue to repeat myself, you only know 98% of who they really are. Remember the old radio show? But evil lurks in the heart of men.
Mm-hmm.
The shadow knows. And the shadow knows that
everything.
Lovelace wasn't loving.
No, obviously, something went horribly wrong.
As you just indicated.
On that night.
It didn't. Something went horribly wrong for her.
She couldn't get the pillow off her face.
Right. That's what went horribly wrong for her. But for him, he thought he had got away with murder.
06, that's what? Seven years.
8 years ago.
Well, they opened up the case in December last year. Yeah, pretty much 8 years ago.
There's no statute of limitations on murder. Mm-hmm.
So. And with forensics the way they are now, you know, he's thinking, I'm a lawyer.
I can get away with it.
Come on.
Did you know, within the legal profession, they catch one of their own, they want to hammer him.
Oh, yeah.
Obviously, he never watched them old Perry Mason show, man. Come on. You will get caught.
That's TV. Dude.
Right. You will get caught.
Well, he got caught. Bring it into a current reference.
Is that Perry Mason?
I still watch Perry Mason.
Rockford. That's because that's what you get. Those two PBS stations.
Yeah.
Hold.
Twilight.
Vertical.
Twilight Zone and all those. Yeah, man. That was quality television.
Oh, no doubt. We're just saying that in 2014.
What kind of quality entertainment you going to have other than football games, baseball?
Well, we're just saying that.
Housewives of Atlanta or something like that?
That, you know, you've got CSI, NIC. ABCB, blah, blah, blah. I mean, you got some current references you could have used.
CSI, Miami, CSI.
You could have said Barnaby,
but
Jones.
Hold on, this was my choice though, correct?
Well, we're just trying.
Correct?
We're just trying to bring you up, bro.
Well,
that's all we're saying. Don't be no jive turkey on this situation.
This was my choice, and I chose Perry Mason.
Okay. Hey.
If you guys want to go with CSI or whatever ABCs you was doing, that's cool. I got no problem with that.
All right, man. Slow down, bro.
Well, let me start it up in here.
You already did. Don't Lovelace me.
Sure, I'll be like Peyton Manning. I've even got up in your grill.
Yeah,
I'll pull a Peyton Manning and get fined. $8,258.50.
And all the pizza we can eat for
a
week.
I was going to say, that's a Papa John reference right there.
How do you get fined that much?
That was just...
You're Peyton Manning, and we've got to find you.
Right. So we got to just come up with something.
$8,258.
All for talking stuff.
And it wasn't much either.
Nah. But I think they understood what the league was trying to do there. It's symbolic.
Yeah, that's all it was.
You know,
he's Peyton Manning.
He's Peyton Manning.
We gotta find him something.
You know, I understand Peyton Manning was out there protecting Wes Welker.
Yeah, that was a nasty hit on Welker too.
Yeah, he got a concussion.
But he's prone to concussions though. He's no longer New England.
If you think about what happened in that hit, Welker's what, 5'8"?
On a good day.
Right. And he became 5'4" on that play. Because when he caught the ball,
you get small.
He got small, right. So now most guys who are 6 feet or bigger, their shoulders are at his head.
Anyway, to start with.
Right. And when I turn to hit, I don't even have to leave with my helmet to hit him in the head. And I think that's, you know, what the guy was talking about, is that he didn't mean to give Wes Welker a concussion. But
well, the other thing is Welker goes, what, 150 soaking wet? So it's always going to look worse than what it really might be.
And your two issues you're dealing with now on Welker's side, this is the third concussion in 10 months.
There's a protocol.
And so, you know, I can understand why Peyton's upset.
Pissed. Yeah.
Because that's his guy.
Mm-hmm.
His bailout guy was Wes Welker.
I like what Peyton said about the fine. Money well spent.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then he stood straight up and waddled on back to the
took
the
a 6 foot six self and
well, he
made a pizza.
His head and neck are 6'4", so.
Even more so nowadays.
Rams quarterback, again, out for the season.
Sam Bradford.
They should draft a new quarterback.
Think about the fact that the Rams were in conversation before this year's draft about do they insulate themselves by drafting because they had a high draft pick, do they take a quarterback? And the answer was no. And this is the toughest thing about making those decisions. Damned if you do.
Damned if you don't.
Damned if you don't. Because if he doesn't get hurt, now you got a first-round pick languishing on the bench. And now, it's, you know, now you got San Diego when Phillip Rivers and Drew Brees were together. And you got to make a decision of who's going to be your franchise quarterback. But now.
San Diego picked wrong, didn't they?
Yes, they did. But they picked based on money. And yeah, I think what, you know, hurts a lot of these teams. And now you bring up the fact, you know, Sam Bradford tears his ACL a second time. And a second ACL tear in the same knee is a minimum. A minimum of 1 year rehabilitation. Because they say everything is worse. The pain threshold is worse. The swelling is worse. I mean, everything that you have to go through is worse. And
let's look at the injuries overall during this preseason. It's been a lot.
Mm-hmm. See, Cam Newton has hairline fractures in ribs.
Yeah. So, you know, that subject then came again about limiting preseason games to two.
Shouldn't be any. I still go to the fact this is professional football.
So what, you go from preseason to playing ball?
Yes. The purpose of preseason
to get in shape.
Hey, and that's what it used to be about.
Well, you hitting somebody else other than your own players.
But football is now a year-round sport with OTAs and mini camps and rookie camps and.
They get what, 4 months off, maybe?
I'd say two.
Months, 2 months, something like that. Yeah.
The month of March you're off. That's free agency. You figure the season, Super Bowl ends in February.
Right.
So once you're off March, April, you got veterans reporting. Then you get the draft in May now, because the draft was moved from April to May.
Then you got OTAs.
You got rookies, and then you got OTAs, and then you got mini camp, and then you got training camp. And back in the day, it used to just be training camp. So you needed preseason, as you just indicated, to play yourself into shape.
Well, back in the day, Super Bowl was in January.
Right. So the season is expanded. And as we talked about a few weeks ago on this, the money generated for preseason games goes to the owners. Players don't get any of that money. They get paid on their contract for the regular season.
16 games.
And you mean to tell me, as I've said it before, that you're not good enough evaluator to determine who should be your 53 guys on your team based on all this other stuff they do?
Not your rookies.
Why not? You can't watch your rookies and...
You've seen film of them since high school.
Right. You don't get preseason in high school or college. Guys go out. Coaches make decisions. Mike's going to start. Sarge, you're going to be his backup.
And then after game one and I'm sucking, you're coming in. You're starting next week.
I would be coming in anyway, dude.
So say it, the baseball player.
Yeah. Well, even nationwide.
Sergeant football.
Even nationwide, is it on your side?
Whoa. How long did you practice that in the mirror?
I've been saving that all week.
That like practice spontaneity.
I've been holding that one all week.
Yeah, well,
never had a chance to use
it. I'm surprised it wasn't on Facebook. I'm surprised.
It'll be on there later on. Nationwide is not on your side.
I got a State Farm one too, just wait a minute.
Okay. Just don't hit me with the
double check. All right, what else we got here in the NFL? Josh Gordon, NFL say they don't want him.
1 year?
Yeah, he's suspended for smoking marijuana.
This is supposed to be his fourth infraction.
He likes the weed, man.
But remember what I said
about where you work.
Right. He's self-medicating. And they say a lot of guys choose to smoke weed than to take prescription painkillers.
I told you, pretty soon the whole league gonna be on prescription marijuana.
And
okay.
If it works to alleviate the pain of the contact that these guys go through on a regular basis.
It's not a narcotic, so it's not truly habit forming.
Right.
or yeah, I guess that's, yeah, you don't get addicted to weed. Maybe in your mind, but then your mind's kind of having the munchies anyway, so.
And I think we've seen so many, you know, obviously the recent with Le'Veon Bell and LeGarrette Blount. That's just, every time you say that, it's just.
Yeah.
A thousand jokes follow behind that. You know, you got two teams. I mean, the way you have to look at this, you got two teams in the NFL who play in states that have legalized marijuana.
Well, actually, you can even include Chicago because, yeah, it's
well
not the, legal.
The point is, on that one, yeah, you got 20 states that have medical marijuana. So you would include Chicago in that.
And you know if I'm in the NFL, I can pay a doctor to write me a prescription.
There you go. Because if they can write the prescription for these guys to get estrogen for masking agents, they definitely can do it for other stuff. And then you got six states that have just decriminalized marijuana. So you've got basically almost 30 states out of 50. So two-thirds of the State of the Union
is smoking.
Or at least legally smoke. With some technicalities here and there. But Josh Gordon, because of the current CBA, has to sit out a year, and because of the collective bargaining and his contract, he can't go work anywhere else.
Well,
so he can't go to Canada.
Yeah, CFL official said that he would not be eligible to play because teams are prohibited from signing suspended players of any league who is under contract with his league, so he couldn't go there and play anymore.
Right. So, Josh Gordon.
Isn't Terrell Owens playing in CFL? Or is that Ocho Cinco or whatever his name?
Yeah, him too.
Chad Johnson.
Yeah, that dude.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, I mean,
Ocho Cinco is playing in arena ball.
It's a paycheck.
Right.
It is indeed.
But yeah, I think that, you know, this, as we talked at the beginning of the show with the domestic abuse, societal changes are going to affect sports in terms of there's going to have to be some other changes with collective bargaining, especially when it comes to quote-unquote substance abuse.
Man, in an ever-changing world.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Well, we got to take another break. When we come back, high school football gets underway tonight.
Man. Everybody was undefeated.
You know, I was watching the news last night. I was thinking about when the last time I've been to a high school football game.
Didn't they give you, like, king of the court one year over the banner?
That was when I graduated in 84.
Thank God he's gone.
Lifetime achievement. Yes. First student who achieved a PhD from high school.
In fact, we had a class reunion coming up here. Yes.
Oh, your 30 year?
Huh? 84, is that 30 years?
When we come back from break, I got to brag a little bit about my teacher.
Uh-oh. He's got brass knuckles.
I see that.
So he's ready to fight.
We're going to give away these tickets. What do you say? Caller number what? Six. Caller number six. Give us a call at 359-9227. Jazz, that's caller number six.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
At 359-9227, we got this other pair of tickets. This is section 130, row 15, seats 11 and 12.
For the 11 o'clock a.m. game tomorrow.
Right.
Morris Stadium, Youngstown State. It ought to be a W.
Yeah, but get you outside, number one. If you're an Illini fan, it gets you close to watching your favorite team.
And if you're tailgating, let me know. I like to be at one. You can play Flippy Cup. I was explaining to Mike how you play Flippy Cup. All right, we'll be back right after these.
Welcome back. Talking Sports at BC.
minutes.
20 minutes to be exact, something like that.
Mm-hmm. Got another winner. Winner, winner, chicken dinner. Oh. Youngstown State, Illinois. 11 o'clock kickoff.
Patricia Frazier, or Pat Frazier, won two tickets to see the University of Illinois play football tomorrow. Thank you very much. Along with Martell Miller. Now, Martell, when he won his tickets, what, about an hour ago, claimed that he was en route to pick his up.
Mm-hmm.
But he has yet to show.
Yeah, I know there's some construction going on Prospect. And
it's a long way from general delivery.
Right. And trying to get that horse through that traffic.
Well, he better put the whip to him, because if he's not here by 5...
And you a jive turkey.
I'm standing out on 4th Street. Tickets! I got 2 tickets.
You don't be trying to sell them to
me. Oh. Cause, once again. You don't pay for nothing.
I don't pay for nothing. I'm making money.
Well,
it's not easy.
Pimping ain't easy.
I know it. I remember last year I got caught with a couple I tried to print off. Something about the paper didn't match.
Really? How'd that happen?
That's what I wanted to know.
Oh, my goodness.
I went to the same people they get it from.
Apparently not.
I know
they just didn't have the same paper. It was the same people, wrong paper.
They got, man.
Different stock of paper, yeah.
There you go.
But that's all right. They somewhere under the State Farm Center now.
That's some Jimmy Hoffa type stuff there. When you, they're under the State Farm
under
Center.
The State Farm Center.
White guy didn't say a word.
Anyway, Friday night, high school football
season is upon us.
Starts tonight, and I know Joe. Central's playing somebody. Centennial's playing somebody. Banner's playing somebody. Who they playing?
Going in reverse order, the Banner Tigers are on the road. Over to Normal to play the Normal U-High. Now, Normal U-High is a strong team out of the Corn Belt Conference, actually the number one team. And so Urbana will be going over there. It's going to be a good road test for them. There's a lot of excitement going on over at Urbana. Alex Beckman, quarterback, Jeff Trash Jr., receiver. We've got a lot of athletes over there. The question will be, can they bounce back from last year? They had a 2-7 season the year after they went to the state playoffs and won a playoff game. First time in the history of Urbana High School in doing that. So it'll be an interesting test for the Tigers. This is a game that had to be played because in the Big 12, Decatur Eisenhower and Decatur MacArthur are no longer there. Both of those teams have gone over to the Central 8, which is basically the Springfield area, Rochester, Springfield Southeast, Springfield High, etc. So now that MacArthur and Eisenhower are gone, teams in the Big 12 have had to go out and find non-conference opponents to fill that spot until next year when the Peoria schools come back into the Big 12.
Is Stephen Decatur still a school?
Stephen Decatur is a middle school in Decatur, no longer a high school. Yeah. Building's still there, but being used as a middle school now.
I used to live across the street from Stephen Decatur.
Did you?
You just got MacArthur and Eisenhower now out of Decatur, along with St. Teresa.
Mm-hmm. That's it. Champaign Centennial travels on the road to Morton over by Peoria. Now, there's a lot of buzz over at Centennial because, number one, you've got 20 returning seniors. Pretty big class of seniors when you talk about local football teams, whether it be Central, Centennial, or Urbana. And, you know, you never can have enough experience.
No, you can't.
And when you have 20 guys who have played and the one thing about the senior class at Centennial, most of the guys have played varsity football since they were sophomores. So they've had an opportunity to cut their teeth, you know, when it comes to playing varsity football. And they'll be led by Jimmy Fitzgerald, who's a recruit by the University of Illinois. Stephen Lee, who's a receiver at Centennial, is also a Northern Illinois recruit. Austin Maltby, a
running back, Dominic Stampley and Kyrie Sago, just to name a couple other guys, but Jeremiah Peoples. This team is well-rounded in terms of the talent that they have and the athletes that they have over there. Now, they did lose some key members to their offensive line, and so that'll be probably the – if there's any question mark for Centennial, will be, you know, how will this year's offensive line hold up, not only in terms of protecting Jimmy Fitzgerald, but also opening holes for their running attack.
They're still pretty big on the line.
Yeah. They still got some, you know, Dave Bramlett is one of the kids over there I know personally, and they've got some big boys. Kylan DuBose, a kid that I've known since he was in sixth grade, and, you know, so they've got some nice size over there, and this should be, on paper, the best team in the area. When you talk about the high school teams in the area, based on talent, the Champaign Central Maroons are the only team in town tonight. They take on the Marion Wildcats. Now, for the past couple years, Central has taken on the Marion Catholic team out of Chicagoland, but this is the Marion Wildcats out of Southern Illinois. So they'll be traveling up here actually 2 weeks in a row. Marion will take on Central tonight and then travel back up next Friday and take on Centennial. Now, Central, second, almost 3 hour trip.
Yeah. That's right by Carbondale.
Mm-hmm. So you've got Central with.
They had a federal prison down there.
Yeah,
their second year coach, Nate Allball. And Central will have kind of a mixed bag of tricks in the fact that they do have about 10 to 12 seniors that'll be playing offense and defense for them, but also have a lot of young guys. They'll be operating with Walker Stillman at quarterback. He's a sophomore, an upcoming sophomore for Central, and they've got a couple other sophomores that'll be getting some heavy-duty minutes on the varsity side of the ball. The key for Central will be, since this is the second year in Coach Allball's system, there's been some guys who've moved from the offensive side to the defensive side. So the new replacements on the offensive line, just like what I stated about Centennial, how will they mesh? How will they work? And what will happen there? So like I said, their game kicks off at 7 o'clock tonight at Tommy Stewart Field. So if you don't get a chance to go to Morton to watch Centennial, then you don't get a chance to go to Normal to support Urbana, then travel on over to Tommy Stewart Field over there off of Crescent Drive and support Champaign Central Maroons. And, you know, as we always say, you know, see tomorrow's stars today on a high school level. Now, you know, you've got other schools, St. Thomas More, that'll be kicking off this season tonight. Rantoul, Muhammad Seymour, St. Joe, you know, there's a variety of schools. Danville. Danville's an interesting study in terms of they've got 9 sophomores that'll be starting varsity football this year.
Wow.
So just like what I said about Centennial from a couple years ago, great experience for those young guys. Obviously they have to be talented to be able to play varsity football at that level. And if they are productive as sophomores, imagine that maturation process they'll go through as juniors and seniors and where that Danville program may be in a couple years. You know, they had a couple of down years these past couple of years, but if you think back a few years ago with Dennis Hightower and the team that they had that challenged for state titles in 6A for about 3 years, you know, they may get back to that same level. So it'll be interesting to see, but, you know, bottom line is get out
and catch a ball game.
Catch a ball game. You know, you talked before, you can't remember the last time.
Last time.
I'm surprised at you, man, with that facility they got in Urbana. You know, that
just down the street from them.
There you go. And I know if you showed up, they probably would, you know, have, you know, maybe
they'd stop the game.
They'd have a halftime ceremony, put you in a golf cart, drive you out to midfield, you know, let you wave to the crowd and get you hooked up. So you need to get out to the game.
How much are games nowadays? You know I won't pay for nothing.
Why would I tell you the price? Right, that's the point.
Because I like to know what I'm not paying.
It's irrelevant. For you, it's irrelevant.
Costs don't even matter.
No. Never has. So I don't think you need to worry about that.
Like when we were shortage, we sneak into games.
But no sneaking on this one. No sneaking at her back.
Yeah, they got new fence up and
everything. There you go. It's electrified, too.
I'm Army. I know how to get to go.
There's an early warning system down on mine. Over by the middle school.
Here comes Sarge.
And if you don't want to go see a high school football game, Illinois volleyball kicks off with Stuff Huff tonight. Their annual do flicky where they try to jam 3,000 or 4,000 people into the Huff Hall.
How many do it hold?
I think it holds about 32, according to the fire marshal.
Mm-hmm. So stuff it, stuff huff.
Stuff. They got 3,000 last year. So
they were a few short. Give me a call if y'all need one more. I might show.
I'm telling you.
As long as you ain't got to pay.
Take your binoculars.
Yeah.
I think the other thing to talk about real quick, you know, Mike put the newspaper up here. Illinois basketball recruiter Jalen Brunson. Rick Brunson's son played. He's a guard out of Stevenson, Illinois.
He's on campus this weekend.
He'll be here. He'll be at the Youngstown State game tomorrow. This is that fulcrum we always talk about in terms of when programs start to change.
The tipping point.
If Coach Gross can get an athlete like Jalen Brunson, because Jalen Brunson's the real deal. I mean, he's one of these combo guards that may be a one and done. You know, his dad is a former NBA player who played at Temple back in the day for
John Chaney.
Mm-hmm. And now here it is, Jalen coming into his senior year, coming on campus here at the U of I. The goal is when you get a guy like this, this caliber of player on your campus, is they don't leave until they sign a piece of paper or at least make a verbal commitment. And I think that's going to be the goal this weekend, is that they can get Jalen Brunson.
He's being entertained real good this weekend.
Oh.
Well, so will a kid who comes in next weekend, who's another point guard, I believe. His name escapes me off the top of my head. But they would be happy getting either one of them. They'd be ecstatic getting both of them.
And this takes you back, I don't know if you recall what happened when Derrick Rose and Eric Gordon from Indiana, when they both had committed to Illinois, and then things unraveled.
And take an ACT test.
Right, you know. All of those things happened, and that was really the beginning of the end of Bruce Weber's demise.
Yeah, it was.
And not to say this is the same parallel situation with Coach Gross, but if you want to get in that conversation, that top 10 conversation, you've got to get these type of players.
You got to get at least one of them.
And this is also the conversation, you know, for years everybody kept saying Gross, Weber could coach, but he couldn't what?
Recruit.
He couldn't recruit. John Gross, we're going to find out if you can recruit, because this is, number one, he's an in-state player.
Yeah.
You got to keep, you think about the talent that's left the state of Illinois over the past several years, from Anthony Davis, who played at Kentucky, you know.
All the kids going to Michigan
Jahlil
State.
Jahlil Okafor,
yeah.
Kids
yeah.
going to Michigan State.
The kid out of Bloomington or Normal this year.
Oh.
Diop.
Something. Diop, that's it. And then, you know, obviously we know about Jabari Parker going to Duke. So this is where that 1.7, 1.9 mil, this is the justification. You convince a guy like Jalen Brunson to at least say he's coming. I don't know if he can sign immediately, but.
They all hook him up with you, Joe, so you can take him out and show him the town.
We want him to come here, Sarge.
Discount double check ain't
right.
Gonna cut it.
Now, if we're recruiting his daddy, I can get his daddy to come here. We're talking about a teenager.
Yeah.
Apparently a very well-grounded teenager, yeah. too. Partly because of his dad, who's mm-hmm. got all the experience and whatnot. But, yeah, I mean, if he commits, he's going to join a recruiting class that's pretty darn good so far.
Right. So it'll be interesting to see how this thing plays out this weekend.
All right, congratulations to that Little League World Champion, South Korean, and also congratulations to
Jackie Robinson West,
who took second place, but they, you know, won the United States World Series, so mm-hmm. congratulations to them. Excellent ball game.
Yeah.
If you didn't get a chance to watch it.
It was a good game.
what I enjoyed was watching games every night, whether it be with Monet Davis and the Pennsylvania team or Jackie Robinson West. Like you said, on the international side, the South Korean team was just, they were hitting shoulders better than anybody in the tournament.
Well-disciplined team, too.
I enjoyed the U.S. championship with Nevada against Jackie Robinson. My heart sunk for the kids for Nevada.
They choked.
Well, see, we're talking about 12-year-old kids, Sarge, and that's why I said my heart sinks, because when we use words like that, it's a game.
Okay, well, let me change it.
You know, it's a game.
They started playing not to lose.
Well, they just started playing like 12-year-old kids would play in a
You were feeling the pressure.
Pressure of like 35,000 folks watching you play a game that normally maybe your parents and a few neighborhood friends come and watch you play.
And you could see it on the Nevada pitcher's face, because, I mean, he was fighting tears the last couple, three batters he was out there.
Yeah,
when he reached his pitch
count.
And then when he reached his pitch count and they had to go off the mound, he immediately just walked towards the dugout. Not even, he was so emotionally overwhelmed.
Then he slowed down.
And the coach was trying to get him, hey, I'm not taking you out because I'm taking you out.
Well, the coach had gone out before that and said, hey, look, you're coming up on your pitch count. And you just saw his face just boom.
And then the other thing I feel is that the kid, Austin, is it Krizik?
I think so.
They brought him in to pitch. He couldn't pitch because of his short shoulder.
Oh, yeah.
They put him at second base. And we all know a left-hander does not – that's the worst position, because it goes against everything your body's trying to do. You're turning away from the play naturally, et cetera. And they hit the ball to him.
Very first ball.
And it bounces right through his legs. And you can just – as you talk about that emotion.
He played for the hop.
Yeah.
Well, he was playing to set himself up to make the throw to turn the double play, and it just
didn't work. But, you know, you got to tip your hat to Jackie Robinson. It's a fantastic story on a, you know, so many levels. We don't even have to go into the obvious levels of seeing African-American kids playing Little League, but playing at that level. But the enjoyment I think you saw from those kids in terms of just playing the game.
Yeah.
I think that was, to me, the key is – they had fun playing the game.
I mean, even when they lost to South Korea, you didn't see them sunk their shoulders or hold their head down. You know, they were still upbeat.
Because, as I said, 12 is – that's why when we talk about what Major League Baseball needs to recognize, I know obviously you can't get the youthful exuberance that you get from 12- and 13-year-old kids, but the energy that they showed all the way through that tournament, and when the game ended, I think the thing that I got most enjoyment was you saw the kid from Jackie Robinson and the kid from South Korea, two divergent cultures, and they're sitting there trying to do a handshake hug. That, to me, encapsulates everything of what sports is all about, especially youth sports. I hope it gives a shot of adrenaline. If some kids were watching who maybe thought, you know, do I play baseball or get into it, because that's what it was all about.
All right.
I got to brag real quick. Turn around so everybody can see it.
Micah the Horse Cox.
MMA fighter. That is my oldest child, which you should probably remember, because I had him at Fort Knox.
He was actually down at Fort Knox with him.
Here, let me start the timer. Anyway, he's a fighter, MMA fighter, enjoys it, stays in shape that way.
I don't remember.
Was at a training session last night and got his orbital bone broke. So this walkout shirt was for naught, because he won't
you
be
sure
having
this fight.
Is he pretty good?
He's a bad man.
Anybody who does MMA
is a bad man.
You know.
So anyway, I just want to give him a shout out and hope he's feeling better. He had ended up getting airlifted to the University of Louisville to have some surgery early in the morning to fix his eye bone. So
shout out to Micah the Horse. He kicks like a thoroughbred.
All right, right on, bro. Duck and weave now next time.
No, he just drops people on their head.
That's why he got dropped on his head.
No, my daughter-in-law said it was in the sparring session, he was coming forward as the guy was throwing a punch, and he just caught it right.
That's when you walk into one.
Walked into it? Yeah, he did.
We all have done that.
Oh, yeah. That'll stop you in your tracks.
Yeah.
All righty then. That's going to do it for this edition of Talking Sports. We do this each and every Friday from 2 to 4. Lord willing, and the creek don't rise, we'll be back here next week to lace them up and do it again. You guys be sure and tune in. Mike?
Thank you, gentlemen.
Joseph?
Jive, Turkey.
I don't pay for nothing.